Even a Sunday morning. We acknowledge that, dear God, and we acknowledge it as our weakness. And we acknowledge, dear God, that only you are the source of strength that can free us from the focus on the world, focus on the troubles, even the joys, and to sometimes and so easily forget the giver rather than simply enjoying the gifts. We pray, dear God, that you will guard our hearts from idolatry this morning of ease, of prosperity, but instead turn it to worship as we are thankful and out of glad and grateful hearts that we ask for your help today. We know, dear God, as we ask for your help, you are honored because you are honored where you are dependent upon. And so make it so in this place, we humbly ask through Christ. Amen. To all who are weary and all who need rest, to all who mourn and long for comfort, to all who are weak and frail and yet desire strength, to all who feel worthless and frankly wonder if God even cares, to all who sin and need a Savior, this church opens wide her doors with a welcome from Jesus. He is the mighty friend of sinners. He is the ally of his enemies. He is the defender of the indefensible, and he is the justifier of those who simply have no excuses left. In Jesus' name, welcome. Hear the word of the Lord from the prophet Isaiah, some 8 centuries before the Lord Jesus would come into the world as an incarnate child. Isaiah chapter 9 reminds us that the people who walked in darkness, they have seen a great light. Those who have dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You, O Lord, have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. And they, the nation, they rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For, or because, the yoke of his burden and the staff on his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you, O Lord, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for fire, for unto us a child is born, and to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father and Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. And on the throne of his father David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness, from this time and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. Amen? Let's join our voices as we praise God together in song.
The pastor had a very interesting few choice words in the back as we were praying in preparation for service. He said, truth is not trivial. And how do we know truth is that we take it from the word and the mouth of our living Father. And sometimes the truth is hard to understand. And I do hope that we take time to meditate on it and consider these words as we sing, My God, Savior, My God. I am not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at his right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of him to be my Savior.
that he would leave his place on high and come for sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God he was, my God he is, my God he's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God he was, my God he is, my God he's always gonna be. Yes, living died me, let me bring my strength, my solace in this spring, that he who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior, that he would leave his place on high and come for sinful man to die. Count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God he was, my God he is, my God he's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God he was, my God he is, my God he's always gonna be. My Savior lives.
This is one of my favorite songs. Wonderful, merciful Savior.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and Friend, who would have thought that a Lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we praise, you are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope and our hearts have hopelessly lost our way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. You are the one that we praise, you are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before. before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Praise God, you may be seated. Excuse my hand.
Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to Thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Father, when we find ourselves perplexed and discouraged, confused and unsure of this life, we say with your prophet Jeremiah that each morning, dear God, your grace, your faithfulness, your assurance of your care for us is brand new. You do not ask us to get by today on yesterday's grace, but for the fresh grace that you pour out today. You are such a faithful God. Your love is always dependable. Your compassion never fails. Your care for us is sure and certain. And I pray, dear God, for those who have come into this room today feeling perplexed and confused, not sure how to get through and deal with this life. I pray, Heavenly Father, that the arms of Jesus would be that welcome that they require, that they would see the reality of his grace being poured out, and that you, dear God, would be glorified and made much of as you pour out your mercy on your own. We pray this day in Christ's name. Amen. Well, again, friends, we're glad that we're part of this worship service this morning. Thank all of you for coming to this place. I appreciate in particular the time that the worship team was putting in and the effort today. We had some power outages and all kinds of other technical things, and yet God just continues to show up, but glad for the way that he continues to use his servants. Today being the second Sunday of Advent, we do have some announcements about our Christmas and our Christmas services. The church family is going to be gathering next Sunday morning at the same time here for our annual Christmas program, and that will be here during the service, and then immediately afterwards, we're going to have our congregational lunchtime together. So please come and plan and be in prayer for Anastasia and the other folks who are involved in Sunday school as they get the children prepared for something special next week, and then please, please plan to stay. If you can possibly stay next Sunday, it's such a compliment to those who work so hard to prepare the meal for you. And it's such a great opportunity for us who sometimes are so disconnected geographically and we're busy this time of year. It's a great opportunity for us to connect together. So next Sunday morning and then immediately after church to have our church luncheon. With respect to Christmas Eve services, Christmas Eve, as you probably know, is the following Sunday on the 24th, falls on a Sunday this year. So nothing complicated in the morning, same worship time, 10:30 in the morning. But then in the evening, we will also have our annual candlelight service, and we'll do that at 6 o'clock in the evening. And that gives you a little bit of time. Some families who bring their children or some folks who have other things to do later that evening, we can do both rather than having to choose one or the other. It is a particularly somber and special and reflective time on Christmas Eve. We do tend to dim the lights. We have some candles. We sing together. We worship over the word. It is a very special time. And honestly, it's one of the few times that we as a church have a real outreach, that other folks will come on a Christmas Eve service, that they don't always come the other times of the year. So it's a very, again, special time. And if you could plan to come, we'd be very glad for you to do that. We're going to continue to sing. So please stand as we worship the Lord in song.
Glad some tidings be.
which inspire your heavenly song. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Light and life to all he brings, raised with healing in his wing. Mild he lay his glory. born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Hallelujah. Please have your seats, friends. We are particularly grateful for all aspects of the ministry of our church family. One aspect in particular is the next generation ministry. That's another fancy way of saying Sunday school or young people's ministry. God has given us precious young lives for which we are responsible, and that as a church family we seek to give prayer and proclamation, give care and discipleship even to these young lives, that they would be pleased, or that God would be pleased to make them pleased to trust Him for eternity. A couple of the people that do that very clearly are those who teach in Sunday school. In a few moments, we're going to dismiss the kids, and a couple of our church family members are going to give up being up here with you so that they might serve the parents and the children of these families. It is not without sacrifice that folks do that, but I'm glad to say it's also not without joy. And so I want to thank the teachers in particular this morning who have been involved and are going to be involved. These are the teams this year, both Anastasia and Diane, both Pam and Elizabeth, Nina, and I keep saying Gracie. She tells me I can call her Gracie. Tatiana and Akshaya, of course. Ariane and Chester, both as a married team. And Larnie and Andrea have been serving there as well this year. So we're particularly thankful for these men and women who are pleased to care for our children and seek to bring the Word of God to bear upon their life. Just as a note, that this today is the last Sunday school until the new year. Both adult Sunday school and children's Sunday school will be complete today, and then they will resume again on the first Sunday of January. Or is that the second Sunday? I guess it'd be, is that the first Sunday? January 7th, we'll be back to that. So we're going to ask the children to come at this point, and we're going to pray for them this morning as they're dismissed for Sunday school.
Friends, would you pray with us, please? Okay, we're going to pray together. Okay. Father in heaven, thank you for your care for these young lives already today. We acknowledge, dear God, your sovereign care and your concern for these young lives throughout their day. And particularly now, we ask a special outpouring of your Holy Spirit, that you would do so in such a way, dear God, that Larnie and Andrew would be used as your tools, that they would speak the words of life, that you would use the tools that the curriculum that we have are, that all the ministry and means of grace that you've given us here, God, we do pray that today it would be used to bring salvation, to bring sanctification, to bring maturity and growth and assurance in these young lives, dear God. We know, Heavenly Father, that you save, and you save in your time, and you have determined before time began who will be yours. And so we pray, Heavenly Father, that as a means of your grace to bring about your plan, we pray that you would move now until these young folks put their hope in God. We pray.
Before we spend some more time in the Word and preaching over the Word, I do want to pray, and to pray especially for those who find this something less than the most wonderful time of the year. We have had losses in our church family this past year, and we have had losses that are connected to our church family. Miss Linda, and Johan, and Carolyn, most recently, and yet there are tentacles from that, aren't there? There's connections and dots that are connected easily to your families and to the extended families of our church. And this is a time of year, whether you've had a recent loss or if it is a loss that has been in the past. And that doesn't just mean a loss by death. It can be family strife, it can be overt divorce, it can be overt leaving of children and parents. There can be disconnections and challenges at this time of year when so many others are speaking of family and of joy, and there's nothing wrong with that. We don't apologize for that, but we want to be sensitive to the fact that there are some that find this the most difficult time of the year. The great thing is God knows that. God knows and God cares. And God is doing more than caring. God is moving. And God is eager for us to come to him as we sang, "Great is thy faithfulness." Morning by morning, new mercies we see. Sometimes it's just new mercies we seek. Sometimes it's just new mercies that we know we should seek. We're not always sure how to do that. It's a beautiful reality that the Lord Jesus Christ knows what we need before we ask for it. That the Lord Jesus Christ gives us far more than we ask for. Sometimes we don't get things because we don't pray, the book of James says. But again and again and again, if you just think about the last couple of hours of your life, what you have not asked for, and what God is pleased to glorify himself by pouring out to you. I was thinking again the other day, Jesus said when he was teaching in the upper room discourse in John 15 that you are going to have sorrow in this world, but your sorrow will be turned to joy. And that might be in the short term. It might be in the longer term, as Steve was teaching us in Sunday school today. God always promises blessing. He doesn't always promise blessing right away. And he doesn't always promise blessing in the form or the shape that we've asked for it. That's why we pray to one who is our Father, like little children whose parents know better than us and are willing to give better than even we ask. I remember saying to one of our seniors group years ago in Sunday school that, remember, God has been caring for you when you didn't care that God was caring for you. That's a great truth. And I want to pray this morning that, as the slide says, that the Prince of Peace, for those who find this a difficult year, might feel enveloped and welcomed into the arms of Jesus. A collection of Puritan prayers in the Valley of Vision reads this way, and I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and pray with me as I pray this together. O Spirit of God, we ask for help with our infirmities. When we are pressed down with loads of sorrow, perplexed and not knowing what to do, even slandered or persecuted, when we are made to feel the very weight of the cross, help us, we pray. If you see us and you see in us any wrong thing encouraged, any evil desire cherished, any delight that is not your delight, any habit that grieves you, any nest of sin in our heart, would you grant us the kiss of your forgiveness and teach our feet to walk in the way of your commandments. Deliver us from overwhelming cares and make us both happy and holy people. Help us to walk, even in a separated life, with firm and brave step, and to wrestle successfully against weakness. Teach us to laud, adore, and to magnify you with the music of heaven. And make us to be a perfume of praiseful gratitude to you. Do not allow us to do anything but to exalt you even in the face of loss and of difficulty, whether recent or annual memories. Give us the power to live as your child in all of our actions and to exercise the sonship that you have promised to us by conquering ourselves. Preserve us from the intoxication that comes from prosperity. Sober us when glad with joys that do not come from you. Lead us safely into the eternal kingdom, not asking whether the road should be rough or smooth, but to request only that we see the face of the one we love, to be content with bread to eat and clothing to put on, and shelter that you give us in this world. I ask specifically now, dear God, You who know us better than we know ourselves, certainly better than we know each other. For those who need the special dispensation of your grace, we pray, dear God, that you would give that now. And then in giving it, you would be the one who's made much of, that you would be the focus, that all of our prayers would come to the ultimate culmination, that your name would be hallowed in our lives. We pray these things through Christ. Amen. I'd like to ask you to take your Bibles at this time as we spend some time in devotion over God's Word and look to the Gospel of John. John, the fourth of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and then John, and chapter 18. If you do use the Bibles in the pews, you will find John chapter 18 on page 904 or on page 1075. As you're turning there, let me add my thanks to those of you who were so kind to my brother Godfrey Thurgood last Sunday as he was here to bring the word. Thank you for those of you who participated in the service and held down the fort, as it were. We were very grateful that Pam and I had a little pre-Christmas respite and are back feeling refreshed, although Pam is still feeling a bit difficult with her health, and I know her, like so many of you, find this a difficult time of year health-wise. I know so many folks that are struggling, but we're glad that we can pray to a God who hears us and a God who sustains us even in the midst of difficulties. John chapter 18 is a passage that speaks of a particularly difficult time for the Lord Jesus Christ. And although it is the second Sunday of Advent, and you think Christmas text, we think of the second chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, or the first and second chapter of the Gospel of Luke, and we think John chapter 18, as you can tell, is a more of an Easter scripture. It's Jesus standing before Pilate and being questioned by him, but Jesus redeems this text for Christmas, if you will. He points not to the end of his life, but he points to the very purpose of the end of his life. And so John chapter 18, may I ask you to stand with me, please, as we read God's word together, beginning at verse 33. Hear the word of the Lord. So, Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Well, do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Verse 35, Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? It's your own nation, and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting, that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." Then Pilate said, "Ah, so you are a king." Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. Listen now. For this purpose I was born. For this purpose I came into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." And Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" Father, as we come to your word now, I humbly ask for help from the pulpit to the pew, that the Holy Spirit, who's been promised to lead us into all truth, would do that very thing. Magnify the name of the Lord Jesus and cause our lives to magnify him by being conformed all the more to his image. We need you, Heavenly Father. We love you. And we ask, dear God, that out of that love you have for us, that is the very reason we have a love for you, that we would now pursue godliness and Christ-likeness by your word, by the Spirit and power of your Spirit, we pray in Christ. Amen. Please have your seats, friends. There is a short outline there. If that's helpful for you to use, you're welcome to do it. As Ark said at the outset, we have a very clear call in this scriptural text before us today that is this: do not let truth become trivial at Christmas time. Truth is not trivial. Therefore, the injunction for us is don't let it become trivial, particularly at Christmas time. Now, I say that word trivia, and you may think, call to mind the board game Trivial Pursuit. I was thinking about that this morning. It's interesting to pursue trivia. Well, that's really what guys like me, or at least guys that are wired like me, tend to do. Way back in 1981, 40 plus years ago, this game came out. It had all kinds of interesting facts, and you can sit around and, you know, show everybody how smart you were when you were able to guess trivial ideas. The whole concept there is that it's things that don't really matter. They're true, but, you know, they're trivial. They're small. They're not things that are particularly essential to your life. Well, the board game held on to its popularity and increased and increased and increased, and there was all kinds of spin-offs and all kinds of specialty board games, one of which started to become this movement about 25 years ago of Bible trivia. Now, of course, everyone who said Bible trivia didn't mean these things are unnecessary or they don't matter. But before you know it, that ends up being what these kind of things are like. They feel like they're trivia. We would play Bible trivia games. Maybe some of you have done this in a youth group or in a group at even this time of year. You might sit around and say, we're going to play some trivia and see about who knows these particular things. It was a dangerous pattern, and it was a dangerous and slippery slope, because Bible trivia soon meant that we started to take little particular details in the scripture, not as essential words of life, but as interesting facts that can be kind of used for amusement and not really brought to our lives. And so we have invariably this time of year a Christmas trivia. Sometimes we have it at our Christmas parties or Golden Embers. We used to have those kind of things, these trivia questions. And again, we weren't trying to be insulting, but they didn't seem ultimately important. And so as painful and as difficult as it is for you, are you ready for another annual round of Pastor Pete's painful protest with precise practices at Christmas? I know it's painful. And I know I do this each year. And I did not ask the songs that we were going to sing this morning, so I didn't suddenly change this. But let's think about a couple of things that we do at Christmas time and see how much trivial or trivia they are when we realize that there are things within our own Christmas traditions that they're not trivial, they're just wrong. We sang Hark the Herald Angels Sing today, didn't we? Glory to the newborn King. And the question that, of course, always comes out of that is, do angels sing? And I think that without thinking a whole lot about it, we would quickly say, yes, of course. I mean, we just sang the hymn. John Wesley wrote all about it, that angels are singing. Fact is, brothers and sisters, that you will not find one instance in the scripture. I dare you. Please correct me. I look every year if I missed one. You will not find one instance of angels actually singing. The text that you may be thinking of is in Luke chapter 2, right? Remember when Linus and Charlie Brown's Christmas comes to give the true meaning of Christmas? And he quotes this, right? That then suddenly in the field where the shepherds were, there was a multitude of angels and of the heavenly host praising God and singing. No, praising God and saying glory to God in the highest. Well, surely there's other spots, but like the book of Revelation chapter 5. When John the Revelator looked and heard around the throne the voice of many angels saying, not singing, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Even then in chapter 7 of the book of Revelation, all the angels were standing around the throne and they worshiped God by saying, amen, blessing and honor and wisdom and thanks and glory be to our God. No, the ark, we don't hear angels singing. You have scenes like this in your home, I guarantee it. We have scenes like this in our home. What's wrong with this picture? There's Mary and Joseph and star and wise men and Jesus in the manger. What could be wrong with this? There was no star over the manger. There was never a star over the manger. The star, it was said in Matthew chapter 2, when wise men came from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and we've come to worship him." Well, didn't the wise men come? And there was three of them, wasn't there? Does the Bible say there were three wise men? Gold, frankincense, and myrrh? I understand why we might think that. But no. Bible has nothing to say about precisely how many there were. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, wise men from the east. That's all we know. Again, I understand why we'd say there were three, because there were three gifts that are named there. But it didn't tell us that. More to the point, this is an interesting scene, that when the wise men come to the manger. Well, I just said to you that the star wasn't over the manger, and frankly, neither were the wise men at the manger. No, it tells us again in Matthew chapter 2 that after Jesus was born, not before when Jesus was born, when it said the shepherds were, but after that, in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came and saying, "Where is he who has been born?" Past tense, not who was just born, but has been born. In fact, the star that they had seen when it rose, it went before them until it came to rest, not over the manger with the baby, but over the house where the young child was. So that we don't miss it, Matthew says, "And going into the house, they," the wise men, however many there were, "saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and they worshiped him." After traveling how long? Does the Bible say how long they traveled? You may be surprised, it almost says exactly that. Herod, in Matthew chapter 2, sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all the region. Why? All those who were 2 years old and under, according to the time he had ascertained from the wise men. The wise men told Herod how long they had been traveling. And with that information, Herod decides to get Jesus, it's got to be everybody from 2 years old and under. Remember back in the shepherd's account in Luke chapter 2, when the angel said to them, "Fear not, behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be all the people. For unto you this day, is born in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." The angels appeared. I'm sure there were stars in the sky. I'm not suggesting it wasn't. And the glory of the Lord shone around them. There was brightness. I get that. But he says that was the day when Jesus was born. And the shepherds went to bring their worship to him. Up to 2 years later, the wise men come. Still to Bethlehem, but to a house with the young child, not in the manger. Now, I get it. Don't think you're not thinking this. I can feel you. Who cares? Come on, Pete. You're blowing all of our Christmas traditions, with due respect to our designers here, right? I didn't know that was going to be there. It's not the end of the world. Of course it's not the end of the world. We have certain traditions. We have certain. I've always had that creche with the star over it, right? Creche, another word for manger scene or nativity scene. We've always had the wise men right there, right? I mean, it's just how we celebrate Christmas. And you know what? There's so much about Christmas that we don't do specifically anyway. Why does it really matter? Well, you notice I've kept my comments not to the validity of Santa Claus or Christmas trees, or gift-giving, or mistletoe. Not just historic practices, but actually aspects of the Word of God, which I think you'd agree, whether you think it really matters or not, it's really pretty clear. Here was the manger, here was the star, here's the wise men, here's the timing. The Bible's very clear about those things. And when we say something like, "Well, who cares?" Before we know it, we do have to ask the question, well, then what else is just trivial? What else doesn't really matter, even whether Scripture speaks specifically to it? Think about questions like this. The priority of congregational worship every Lord's Day When someone says you need to go to church every Sunday, what is the opposition say to that? Legalism. Right? We will not forsake the gathering together of ourselves as is in the habit of some, but even more as the day draws near, we just can't wait to be together. The book of Hebrews chapter 10 isn't given as a proof text, but as a joy. We love to be together. And yet, you know as quickly as I do how much congregational worship in our day is an option more than something we think we must do. 20% of this room on average will not be here next Sunday. And 20% who's here this week were not here last Sunday. That's just about our numbers. We keep pretty close track of that. 5-6 years or so, COVID was nuts, of course, so we had a couple of years in the middle there. But there'll be 15 to 20% of us every single week who are here and who aren't here. What about the issue of baptism and church membership? You don't have to be baptized to be a Christian. Church membership isn't a requirement for Jesus. Well, really? How did we get there? If Jesus is the Lord of our life and he tells us to do something, we say, we don't need to do that. We do need to trust you, but we don't need to live the way you tell us to live. And people have struggled with this for ages and ages now. The daily intake of God's word? We're too busy. We'll do it later. We did it on Sunday. I can't possibly have time to read God's word every day. Never mind put it on an app and have it read to me as I drive to my job. We say those kind of things. Before we know it, actual repentance. I don't mean theoretical sinfulness. I mean actually saying, God, I am wrong. I have no excuse. Please forgive me and help me to obey. Not generically, and not saying it to someone who will quickly tell me it doesn't matter, that's okay, I'm not perfect either. No, I mean actual repentance and honest to goodness turning away from my sin and turning back towards the path of God and giving God the glory for that. Service, life in the body, capital O optional. We've talked about the 80%, 20% rule for as long as I've been in ministry, 30 plus years. That 20% of the people do 80% of the ministry. That you can be asked for help and you can actually say, no, I won't help. It's odd. It comes down to just Christian living. What about how we use our tongues, the purity of our thought life? Real, true, and honest mercy and compassion and charity, particularly this time of year. And perhaps what's most difficult of all is to actually examine our own traditions, why we do the things that we do. And those feelings of pushing back that I could feel you, that I'm enjoying you with, when I look at those things that are changing in terms of our Christmas carols or our creches or these different traditions that we have, that pressing back, that defending our tradition, it's okay because it usually ends up being okay because that's what I've done and that's what I like. And my preference makes my practice, and therefore my practice becomes the principle. Rather than beginning with the scriptural principle, moving that to be what I prefer and therefore practice it and live it out. I know it's difficult, friends, but I think Spurgeon is absolutely right when he says, if your creed, that is your traditions, how you live, if your creed and your scriptures do not agree, cut your creed to pieces, but make it agree with this book. Amen? As Bible-believing folks, we want to do that. We want to be folks who are semper reforma. We are the reformers, always reforming, always changing. Is that not what's required for growth? Is change? Forward development? Again, we were talking just in Sunday school. Steve was teaching us about moving forward requires change, because the only growth comes from things actually changing. The challenge is, brothers and sisters, when we come to Christmas time, and I know it's my painful protest about these silly little things that seem silly, but has the truth of Christ actually become trivial? You know, and I know how difficult it is to go to a memorial service, to go to a funeral, to go to some kind of evening of remembrance for someone who has passed on with zero evidence and zero claim of trusting Jesus. And coming to grips with the fact of what the Bible says happens to people who die without Jesus. And how we search some memory of their life, some declaration they said, some good work. Well, they did. Well, at least she did. Well, I used to know. Well, someone said they used to go to. We're just scraping the bottom of the barrel for some little sliver of evidence that they got to be okay. Because the truth of the gospel can become something that is simply a way to get those that we love to a place that we want them to be in. Rather than actually coming to grips with the hard, cold fact that it is appointed for men to die once and then the judgment. Yes, God's judgment, God's conclusion. And that, brothers and sisters, is not trivial. And when we come to a voluntary recognition of the birth of Christ, and I recognize and I acknowledge it's voluntary. The Bible doesn't say we have to have this season. I say if the angels proclaim the glory of God, we should join them. Let's go ahead. It's wonderful. I think if Spurgeon said, since your minds are inclined this way, I will hold forth the glory of the incarnation. I love Christmas time. My wife is a Christmas queen, as I said. We just spent our holiday time going around upstate New York looking at all these beautiful Christmas displays and making our own Christmas holiday. I love this time of year, but it is voluntary. But it cannot and never be trivialized as just some interesting little occasion when the scriptures actually speak to specifics. We cannot allow them to become trivial. So, brothers and sisters, a main thought and three applications. Truth is not trivial. It's not trivial at Christmas because what? The birth of Christ, the account of the birth of Christ, connects us to the gospel. I hope you have your Bibles open still to John chapter 18 as Jesus, in what we think of as Easter time. But Jesus connects it to Christmas time, doesn't he? Standing before Pilate, what does he say there in verse 37? He says to Pilate, you say that I am a king. And this is the reason that I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Not the trivializing of the truth, but the testifying, the proclaiming of the truth. Now, I understand there's more to it than that. It's not the only reason Jesus gives for coming into the world. But that's the one that he gives standing before the Roman governor who had carte blanche authority to do whatever he wanted in this region. We hear about King Herod's and these Jewish kings. They were just puppets of the Roman rulers. These are the occupiers of the land. This is a Roman governor, Pilate, who's in charge of every moment of Jesus' life as far as he's concerned. And Jesus stands before him and he says, are you really a king? And he says, I tell you what, rather than answering your question, I'm just going to tell you what I'm here to tell you. That this is why I was born. The purpose of Christmas Day is a celebration of Jesus' testimony of how it is, of Jesus' declaration of reality. No, it's not just what Christians believe, and others are celebrating Hanukkah, and others are celebrating Kwanzaa, and others are celebrating, yes, I know that. What we are saying is that the gospel of Jesus Christ is how it is. If you don't see it this way, it's an incorrect vision of the world. This is how it is. Jesus is the one who he says he is. In just a few chapters after this, of course, we're going to find the Lord Jesus raised in vindication of all of his claims of being the one that he actually says he is, the true and living Son of God. Friends, There is something about the reality of the birth of Christ that points to the gospel. In fact, it is itself a proclamation of the gospel. Jesus came to testify to the truth. What is that? Coming to preach the gospel. Isn't that what testimony is? Tell me, will you say what's true and the whole truth and nothing but the truth? That's what we say in courtrooms. We have to ask people to say, so help me God. Why do we invoke God's name? Because we expect God to be God of the truth. And if God is helping you, so help me God, you will speak what's true, because God always speaks what's true. You can trust him for the truth. And the gospel is a message of the truth. At this time of year, in particular, right back to the very beginnings of the ministry in the earth of Jesus' incarnation. Actually coming, incarnate, right? Flesh, enfleshed, literally it means. That God as a spirit now came in flesh, veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Hail the incarnate deity. I love that line. Friends, Jesus is come to preach the gospel. This is the purpose for which I was born. What the angels were singing about with the, or at least declaring, see, I'm even saying it, singing the angels, saying it out loud there with the shepherds and with the wise men, and I'm sure with everyone who was there, servants and other people passing by. There's this reality, friends, that it is the truth of the gospel of Christ that's the reason that all of this celebration is taking place. Truth cannot be trivial at Christmas time because the truth of the gospel is at the heart and the center of what we're speaking about. And we know that. We know that's what Jesus came to do. Jesus is saying it as explicitly and clearly as he can. That's why John 18 is much more of a Christmas text than Easter. Or if you like, why Easter is the culmination of pulling right back to Christmas time and Easter, both his birth and his death and his resurrection and his ultimate ascension. And as we wait his second coming, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Some days that's just the best prayer that can come out of our mouths. Just come back, Jesus. Hurry up. Come wrap all of this up to your glory. And since Jesus, therefore, has come to preach the gospel, then how is it that we keep the truth from becoming trivial? I said at the outset, we must not let truth be trivial. Okay, how do we do that? Well, John chapter 18 gives us at least three key aspects of the how-to. The number one thing we must understand so that truth will not become trivial is that we must hear his voice in order to live. Would you agree that your life and eternal life is not something trivial? My goodness, that's why we do what we do, right? Our lives, at the heart of our life's concern, is that we must hear his voice in order to live. John chapter 18 and verse 37, Jesus says to Pilate, everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice. That's how people become of the truth, by listening to his voice. And when people are of the truth, they continue to listen to his voice. That's why we say, although we're not saved by works, we are saved for works. And works display the fact that we are or that we aren't saved. While baptism and church membership are not salvation issues, of course they are. So is prayer. So is Bible reading. So is fellowship. So are all the things that Jesus lays out as expectations for us. You're not saved by those things. But those who are saved will always participate in those things. We will live out the expectation that Jesus has for us. That's how we know. That's what happens. Everyone who is of the truth, connected to, part of, living in light of the truth, listens to my voice. Some of you are hearing this. I'll bet you're in Romans chapter 10, brother. We remember the text that is fleshed out here. After Jesus comes, the Apostle Paul writing to the church at Rome, that this faith comes by hearing. And hearing, how does it come? By the word of God, by the voice of Christ, who inspired the Holy Spirit to come. The Holy Spirit wrote the Bible. The Bible comes to us, and there we have the voice of Christ. We must hear his voice in order to live. That, friends, is not trivial. Back a few chapters in the Gospel of John, the beautiful chapter 10 about the extended allegory of Jesus as a shepherd. Jesus says that I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also. And those I bring, what? They will listen to my voice. I'll bring them by means of my voice. But when I've brought them, they will listen. They will act. They will obey. They will follow me. Chapter 10, verse 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Is she a follower of Christ's voice? That was a diagnostic question for us when our boys were starting to date and looking for a mate. God, is she a Christian? Does she believe in God? Way too easy answer. Is she a follower of Jesus? Are you a follower of Jesus here this morning? You don't look back on a decision to answer that question. You look at your actions, which point to the validity of your decision, which point to the glory of the one who's caused you to make it. God has made us alive together with Christ. It is by grace we've been saved. But we've been saved so that we might perform the good works that God has foreordained that we should walk in them. That Ephesians chapter 2 that Colleen read as a call to worship last Sunday. We must hear his voice in order to live. Secondly, we will keep truth from becoming trivial if we recognize that we must listen to his truth in order to hear his voice. You must hear his voice in order to live. You must listen to his truth so that you'll actually hear his voice. Isn't that what he says? Chapter 18, again, verse 37. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice. Now, anyone who's married, anyone who's had children, anyone who's been in a supervisory role, in an office or a business or on a team, knows that you can hear what someone's saying, but you're not listening. Right? You're sitting there talking with a person, and you're looking at them, and you're thinking, are they getting any of this? What do you say? Weren't you listening? What? Yeah, yes, of course. Yeah, I was listening. What did you say? I was hearing, but I wasn't listening. Listening and hearing are not the same thing, are they? I'm not paying attention. I need to be focused. I need to drink it in. I need to be prepared to take action based on what I have heard. That's what listening is. In order to hear him to live, we must listen to his voice. And friends, the only place we listen to his voice with absolute certainty now is in his word. This is what he's given it to us for. This is why Jesus is saying, I've come to testify to the truth. And that testimony has been written down in a testament. One, an old testament, and one, a new testament. This is the testimony about Jesus. And we have it here in the scriptures. And it's not trivial. Jesus is not just chatting. This is not an interesting Bible trivia game, even if we get it right. Because we can hear these truths. And I dare say in a room this big, some of you are hearing me. But not all of you are listening to me. And of course, it's not me that I'm concerned you're listening to. It's Christ himself as he speaks to you through his word by means of his spirit. You will not live unless you hear his voice. And you will not hear his voice unless you focus and listen to what he's telling us. The third way that we seek to keep truth from becoming trivial is recognizing that followers of Jesus Those are those who've heard his voice. Followers must bear witness to his truth just as he did. We are also called not only to take it in, but to actually bear witness to the truth of Christ. Which means it will not do, brothers and sisters, for all of us to be preachers and pastors and Bible teachers. Not many of you ought to be, the book of James says. On the other hand, it will not do for any of us to say, I'm just not like that. I never open my mouth about Jesus to anyone. I'm just not like that. No, if you're a believer in Christ, you're his child, you are like that. That is what you're like. It looks different in your life than my life, but that is what we're like. That's what he does. He empowers those who have been brought into his family. His sheep hear his voice and they follow him, following his example. He has left us, as 1 Peter 2 says, an example that we might follow in his steps. Now that passage particularly goes on to deal with difficulty, but of course the application is very broad, isn't it? That we who are his followers must bear witness to this truth, must testify to the truth just as Jesus did. Now, we're in John 18. We're going to go to John 15 and then John chapter 20. So either side of our text. John chapter 15, you see Jesus again. This is in the upper room discourse. You know that phrase, upper room? Jesus had desired to eat the Passover meal before he died. And he set apart a certain place that his disciples would go and prepare the Passover. And as they were eating, remember Jesus washed their feet. Jesus convicted and confronted Judas. And then he started to speak and to preach. Jesus' upper room, or Jesus' farewell discourse. The final words of Jesus teaching to his own. It's a very powerful section of scripture. Starts in chapter 14 and moves all the way through chapter 18. And what you have there is Jesus saying here in chapter 15, listen now, the disciples are concerned because he's leaving. And they're starting to realize there's going to be ramifications and sacrifices that they're going to be called upon for this. He says, listen, when the Helper comes, whom I will send you from the Father, the Spirit of truth. Don't miss that. He's called different things, the Holy Spirit. Here he's called the Spirit of truth, or Spirit of the truth. The one who is himself of the truth. The Spirit of truth. Jesus says, I am the truth. The Spirit proceeds from the Son. He's the Spirit of the truth. The Spirit of Christ, he's called in other places. But in this case, it's specifically about the truthfulness of what he's saying. The reality of what he's bearing witness to. Jesus said, I've come to bear witness to the truth. I've come to testify about the truth. And I'm going to send the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father. He will bear witness about me. That's what the Spirit's job is. One old country singer said, the Spirit's ministry is nothing more than bragging on Jesus. That's what the Spirit does. He brags about Jesus. That's how it goes. And Jesus goes on to say in John chapter 20 then, even as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you, his apostles. And when he said this, he breathed on them and said, receive the Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit. So back in chapter 15, he's saying, this is what's going to happen. He's gone to the cross. He's risen again. John chapter 20, they meet the risen Christ and he says, I'm sending you. And I'm sending you by giving you this Spirit who's going to be enabling you, equipping you, calling you, yes, but enabling and equipping you to speak the truth. Just as Jesus bared witness to the truth, so his followers must bear witness to the truth. To keep Christ and his gospel from becoming trivial at Christmas time, we must remember that we must hear his voice to live, that we must listen to his truth in order to hear his voice, and that we must bear witness to the truth. Yes, truth is not trivial. Truth is what causes us to triumph. That doesn't just rhyme. Listen now. Truth is what causes us to triumph and to triumph over the trivia of our own lives. Unless you think I'm suggesting that the burdens that I know you've brought in here, that the challenges that you have here, that the difficulties that are weighing down on you, the less you think I'm suggesting those things are trivial, I only mean in comparison to the beauty and the plans and the purpose of Jesus. Right? To fix your eyes on Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth, they'll grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. The things of earth will become trivial. The struggles and challenges that we have will become trivial in relation to the promise of glory with Christ. David Jeremiah, I think, is right when he says, when we give our lives to Jesus Christ, the things of earth grow strangely dim and the values of eternity grow increasingly bright. Hallelujah. Would you stand with me, friends, as we close our service with a word of prayer? Dear God in heaven, we thank you for the way that you've already answered our prayer this morning. The way, Heavenly Father, that you have been pleased to come to us in grace, to continue to care for us this day, moving us even beyond our own understandings to come into this place, to hear of the work of Christ, his very beginnings in that manger, that he would come, God of God and man of man, our perfect substitute, going on to grow for those 30 plus years and to live under the law of God, perfectly keeping it, not for his benefit, at least not for his salvation, but the salvation of those that he would call to himself, who would lay themselves bare before him, trusting, entrusting themselves to him. So I pray this day, dear God, that as we think about that truth of the gospel, where we see its ultimate vindication in Christ's resurrection from the dead, yes, as the king that Pilate scoffed at him being, yes, as the one who vindicated and justified all the truth claims of his life, as he is now not only risen, but ascended, and is our great high priest, eager to hear our prayers this very morning, always eager to intercede for us. I pray, dear God, that we would lay ourselves bare before you again today. That we would do so, dear God, with the confidence and assurance that comes from your word. The only place where we will find true comfort and true assurance. The only pursuit, not of trivia, but pursuit of truth, that we would see an end to as we find this word is truth. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would be gracious today. Magnify the name of your Son in the lives of our church family here, corporately at Downsview Baptist, and individually in each heart and mind, each ear who's listening to this. Perhaps there are some even online. Perhaps there are some months from now who will come online to hear something of your truth. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you'd be pleased to magnify your Son in fulfilling your plan to draw all those that you have determined before time began would be yours. Grant the gift of faith. Grant repentance. Grant assuring fruit of repentance that we might know that we're yours. I pray, dear God, as we're dismissed now and we have some time to fellowship, that we would do so in the name of and to the honor of our King. We ask you to dismiss us now into your service in Christ's name. Amen. We're dismissed, friends. Thanks for being here.